Auto-failover groups are a relatively new feature of Azure SQL. I don't know a lot about it, but Anna is here to tell us how and when to use them. Today, on Data Exposed. Hi, this is Data Exposed again, and I'm your host, Jeroen, and today I'm joined by Anna. Welcome.
Thanks, Jeroen.
And we're going to talk about auto-failover groups, which for me is a completely new subject. So I'm just going to ask and start with the basics. What are they?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So geo-replication for Azure SQL has been around for Azure SQL database for a while. And what this allows you to do is basically create readable secondaries in other regions or the same region.
Now, right.
More recently, we introduced auto-failover groups, mm-hmm. which add some certain capabilities to that.
Okay, so let's imagine I'm a customer, I have, you know, everything set up, I'm happy, so why would I consider using auto-failover groups now?
Over geo-replication.
Yeah.
Yeah, good question. So auto-failover groups, like I said, are for different things in a way. And I actually pulled up this great comparison chart that you can use to decide what's best in your scenario, because it will depend. So for example, if you need something like automatic failover, so mm-hmm. if something happens and you need to switch your primary and secondary, then failover groups is kind of the way to go.
Okay.
On the other hand, if you want to deploy in the same region mm-hmm. As your existing one, then geo-replication is the way to go, because that's not something you can get with failover groups today.
Okay.
And then another thing to call out is that failover groups are supported in managed instance, mm-hmm. Whereas geo-replication is not today.
Right. So now that I know a little bit about, you know, when would I use when, what link, can we include that link in the description?
Of course.
Cool. So let's make sure that we do that. So how do I get started then? I mean, I can probably run some commands, I would hope.
Yeah, exactly. Great question. So what we have today that we want to walk through is this tutorial. So
okay.
You know, I really think that after this video, you should go give it a spin. Mm-hmm. And I think you'll learn and kind of see how this works. So this is a tutorial we're going to walk through. What you do is you create a failover group. We're going to use PowerShell. And then we'll run a Java application to kind of see if and how we're able to connect, read, and write from our primary and then our secondary and our failover group.
Cool. I'm excited to see it.
Cool.
Yeah.
Let's get it going. So what I have here is I have Azure Data Studio on one side, and on the other side I have this Java application running. Now I've already done some stuff to prepare this, but so we'll talk about what's going on here in just a second. So what you have to do in order to get this started is first we're going to use the AZ module in PowerShell. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to go ahead and set the subscription that I want to use.
Sure.
And once I do that, then I can create a backup server in the failover region. So this is something I went ahead and did. It just takes a few minutes.
Okay.
We basically create that backup logical server, mm-hmm. and then we'll select the databases we want to move over, and then we'll kind of do a copy in a way of the original.
Cool. And this is also a great reason why we're using notebooks here, right? Because you just said I ran the commands, and we can see the results here.
Exactly. A great reason for using notebooks.
Right.
So this is the command that shows how to create a failover group. So now I'm just kind of linking my original server mm-hmm. and what I've called here my DR server, so a disaster recovery server.
Right.
And then I'm giving that failover group a name. Now when I want to connect, I will just connect to the failover group name, and I can show that, and either using just the normal .database.windows.net or adding that secondary for the secondary in this
okay.
case.
Okay. Check. Okay, so you set it all up?
Yep, so we set it all up. We mm-hmm. added the database to the failover group. We can go ahead and check the role of that DR server. So
okay.
in this case, it's running a secondary.
Right, as
so,
to be expected.
Exactly. So mm-hmm. now I can give a little bit more info on what's happening over here. So what you'll see is for each line, there's an insert and there's a read. So what we're trying to see is, can we insert on the server that we've identified as the primary, so our
okay.
main server.
Right.
And then are we able to use that second server as a readable secondary? So we're basically using T-SQL in the app to do an insert of a row, and then mm-hmm. we're trying to read that row from the secondary.
And right now, both the write, so the insert and read, are successful, right?
Right, so they are cool. successful. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and spin this off. And what this command does, if we take a look at it, is we are switching. And what that means is we're gonna switch the primary and the secondary in this case, or failover
right.
to the secondary.
So we're just basically forcing the failover now to just make sure it works.
Exactly.
Okay.
And now, so what's gonna happen is as this switch happens, there will be a brief time where you might not be able to insert or read.
Right, so I'm assuming that my app needs to be able to handle that somehow.
Yes, so that's a very important thing to call out, is that having retry logic in your application is super important.
Okay.
So that this doesn't bring you down and you're still able to fail over. So
right.
we can now see on the left what happened. We had two times where we tried to insert and read and it was unsuccessful. But now we can see it's successful again. So now we're able to switch and we can confirm that by running this command before and checking the role of that DR server, and
right.
now we see it's running as the primary.
Yeah, okay, cool. So basically we've been able to prove that this works, and then with our retry logic in our application, we've been able to restore basically the connectivity after a small time of like downtime, right? A little bit.
Exactly, and mm-hmm. we can also fail back as needed, and you'll kind of see the same results.
But right.
Yeah, it's a simple tutorial to just kind of really kind of bring home what's happening behind the scenes and how important retry logic is.
Right, so cool. So I encourage you to try the tutorial, go check it out, go check out the app and the retry logic and give it a spin. And thanks, Anna, again, for sharing this with us. I hope this was useful. Please like, subscribe, and comment, and I hope to see you next time.